Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you're ready for the final session of the 13th Eurasian Media Forum, which I'm sure is going to raise some interesting points. I'm always sad at this stage where we've had so much interesting discussion and we're reaching those final stages. Just before we get going, if I could ask just to spread the word. We always look after our delegates, as you know, and one of our long-term delegates here, Gunter Knabe, from Deutsche Welle, his bag went missing. He has one of the Eurasian Media Forum bags. So if anyone knows of a bag that was accidentally taken, it's Gunter's bag, and he lost it yesterday. He's looking for that. So please do spread the word, and if you do find that, contact the registration desk, and we'll make sure Gunter gets it back. I heard a wonderful story just outside during the coffee break about optimism and pessimism, because listening to the European Union debate, there were those who were mostly optimistic and some, of course, a little pessimistic. And I was told that there is an expression going around Astana right now about optimism and pessimism, and that is when there is an empty glass on the table, the pessimists come and look at it and say, oh no, they started drinking and they finished without me. And the optimist comes and says, oh, they haven't started pouring yet. So we'll try to remain optimistic for this conference. Well, now this session is entitled The Dream Factory as an Instrument of Influence on Society, Business and Politics in the Cinema Industry. And that's, of course, looking at the kind of influence the media through the cinema industry has had on mindsets and how it's changing things. So I'm going to ask our moderator to come up and introduce the panel. We're very honored to have with us the reviews editor and chief film critic at ScreenDaily.com, Fionnuala Halligan. Fionnuala, come on up.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this final session. I hope it will prove a cause for optimism, give us all something to look forward to. We're going to talk about the Dream Factory, about cinema, its influence on business, on politics, on our cultural landscape. And we have some fantastic experts who are experts in their fields, various fields. We have, and I'll invite them to the stage now. So could we have Ray Hammond, please? He's a distinguished futurist from the United Kingdom. Ray? Next, we have Oleg Ivanov, who's the first deputy chairman of the Union of Cinematographers in Russia. Oleg. We also have Charles Lei from China, Thunder Pictures in China. Charles. Gulnara Sasanova, film producer, distinguished film producer from Kazakhstan. Welcome, Gulnara. And Mr. Tony Watts of the Festivals Channel in the UK. I just wanted to give a brief introduction to this session. We're looking at cinema, its influence, and the sort of time that we're in right now to set the stage. It's a time of great change for the film business. Digital delivery has thrown up huge possibilities, and there's mass consumption now of the moving image on a level that we've never seen before. Global box office revenues in 2015 were $39 billion, that's from ticket sales. All filmed revenue, $88 billion. And that's sort of been helped, aided by the opening up of China. China revenues were opened up recently, and 48% they went up by last year, and China is expected to outgrow the US as a marketplace for cinema by next year. And we're now in the era as well where a $1 billion film is it's not a regular occurrence, but it's not as unusual as it used to be. Your typical $1 billion film, though, tends to be a studio product from the US. And the US, in some countries, has 90% market penetration. So we're looking at film as a cultural voice, as a business prospect, wanting to know, really, what individual countries should or can do, and where we'll all end up. So I think maybe we'll start with Ray and ask, do you have an idea of which direction the film business is going in, for an overview to start?
Thank you very much, Finn. It may surprise you to know that as a futurist, I think cinema is dying. But I must define what I mean by cinema. Cinema means the traditional producer, studio, distributor, movie theatre model. I believe that film itself has never been more healthy, and it is going to grow. And the storytelling involved in visual media is going to become ever more important. But the film business, the traditional film business itself, is being disrupted by digital technology. Digital technology allows us now to watch movies in the comfort of our own home. And we're able to have a very large screen and superb sound. And it is only going to be a matter of a few years before the existing model of people going to movie theatres and a release of films designed solely for movie theatres first is going to disappear. There will still be a few isolated movie theatres where you will go for a special occasion, where you'll have a meal, you may do some shopping, you'll watch a wonderful movie in superb surroundings. But 95% of movie consumption, even brand new movies, will occur in domestic movie theatres at home, or in clubs, or in similar. What effect that's going to have on the traditional studio cinema business, I'm not sure yet. And this sort of digital disruption is not just affecting the cinema and the movie business, it's affecting media, banking, travel, and even politics. But of course, that's another topic.
Well, I don't know if all our panelists will agree with that, and perhaps they can address it as we go forward. But Charles, I'd like to move over to you and talk to us a bit about your experience in China. Maybe last year in China, Fast and Furious 7 took $379 million, but there are only 34 international films allowed into China every year. What's the future? Do we protect the marketplace? Do we open it wide and see what falls down?
But before I address China specifically,
sure.
I'd like to perhaps disagree with Ray. I absolutely think cinema is thriving. I agree with you. I'd like to differentiate between content creation, content consumption, in that middle layer where it's the distribution system. I believe Ray is absolutely spot on when it comes to the distribution, when the propagation of the content, but I absolutely do not agree when I say content creation absolutely is flourishing globally, and also content consumption. Movie going is a social experience. Of course I could sit at home and watch on a big 50-inch high-definition screen a particular movie. But certain times, it's a social experience. It's a social experience. You want to go out on a date. You want to have a meal. And what happens afterwards after a movie? It's a life experience. And so you don't want to go to a movie every day. That's a television, internet, mobile phone, but as a special occasion. So that's the slight disagreement. In terms of China, the cinema business is absolutely booming. When you say 34, let's ignore that for a bit. There's 650, 680, I do not remember the exact number, local films being made in China. The boom in China isn't the studio films from America, it's the local production, the biggest box office that exceeded Fast and Furious in China. It was a local Chinese movie called Monster Hunt, which just recently, I think last month, was exceeded by another local Chinese movie called Mermaid. And so the Chinese cinema industry is absolutely booming. The Chinese screens are growing 22 screens a day. So it's a good time to be in the film business in China.
Do you think, just to pursue that one, do you think that the influence of Chinese cinema, because obviously 379 million means a lot to the Hollywood studios who are making these films, do do you think the strength of China is going to influence not just how films are financed, but what we see on the screen?
Oh, absolutely. If everyone goes back, I'm 54 years old today. When I was growing up, the Soviet Union, the Russians, not today, but in life. I mean, but what I mean by that is when I was growing up during the Cold War, the Russians, the Soviets were the bad guys. And for a while there in the 1990s, the Chinese became the bad guys. But due to market forces, today it's the North Koreans that are the bad guys. And I'm sorry, we're not far, this is Eurasia, but we're not far from the Middle East. So the bad guys today are Muslim terrorists and North Koreans. Those are the bad guys, and that is absolutely a function of the commercial potential of a certain market with respect to the content.
Can I ask Oleg, could you come in there perhaps and talk about the Russian experience? About, I know that the Russian film industry, the domestic film industry, is quite strong and audiences respond to their own stories. What is happening in Russia at the moment in terms of domestic production versus the major studios coming in?
I should underline that I have paid attention to the questions that were mentioned for this session, and there is some comparison, the mass culture and the individual art, and I think that the perception is being transformed. Elite art and mass culture is something that we had in the 60s and in the 70s. In terms of content and in terms of how people watch it, there are some very serious changes underway, as we are all aware very well about the series that are being created by some of the cult directors. The films are becoming more and more artistic and more sophisticated, and in that aspect, if we were to talk about Russia, then the popcorn movies don't have such a big share, and the audience is not that interested in that. In terms of the Russian produced movies, the most of the popular ones are the drama theater, drama movies, or some historical films. Yesterday, on one of the IMAX movie theaters, I watched the film, The Crew, because it was first shown on the 21st of April, both in Russia and Kazakhstan. I should tell you that The Crew needs probably become one of the leading films in terms of the number of viewers in Russia. And this is a highly artistic, very catching and very patriotic film. In other words, the notion of this mass culture with popcorn, entertainment, and so on and so forth, we have those kinds of films as well. However, in terms of the number of viewers, they don't go beyond 1 million individuals. However, those films that create greater interest, they might attract up to 10 million individuals in Russia. I think that in terms of the share, in terms of the percentage of the Russian films in the market, it's a little bit less than 20% at the moment. In terms of the Kazakhstan market, it's about 12 million visits of cinema theaters per year in the Republic, and over 1 million is about Kazakhstani films. I think that this is a pretty high share in my point of view, as we don't see so many films being produced in Kazakhstan and in Russia either, if we are to compare it with the total number of films coming in from different markets. So when it comes to the domestic internal product and the interest of the audience, the interest towards those products is much higher. This is because we want to see the stories that will touch us, that are close to us in terms of the mindset, mentality, the system of values, and the things that are of concern to us. And certainly when it comes to the subject today, that broadcasting makes our viewers, turns them into zombies and so on and so forth, well, you see, our viewers are pretty selective when we position films as patriotic or something, then we don't attract enough viewers. However, we get a lot of viewers when there is a lot of artisticism in the films and there is a competition among the directors to be able to now involve this broader audience and to use those artistic techniques for that. And this behavior and the growth of the audience, their behavior keeps changing, and we need to take that into account talking about films of markets of films.
Thank you. Tony, can I ask you about film as a cultural product versus film as a business product?
Yes, I've been lucky enough to work in four different continents, so everywhere I've been, you see the different effects of culture and the business of film and how it sends culture around the rest of the world. The best example was I was 5 years in New Zealand, and this little guy was on a short film course called Peter Jackson. He made two or three really bad horror movies, some of which he disowns. And then he did a couple of documentaries which were funded by the state organization. The state television broadcaster, Television New Zealand, had 33% in a pay TV service, 33% in an internet service, and 33% ownership of the television channels, one and two. But they also had a short film fund, and they also invested in local content, New Zealand on air content, which is where Peter Jackson got his start. And two or three years later, he made a couple of movies, and then he made something called Lord of the Rings. And New Zealand, that was the butt of jokes for having 4 million sheep and not much else, became one of the strongest players at that year's Cannes Film Festival, because New Line, at that point was still an independent distributor, put all of their efforts and monies behind it. So the success of the independent film industry and the success of New Zealand as a country producing films was based basically on Peter Jackson and the process that he had learned. All of a sudden, all the Air New Zealand planes were covered with hobbits and little people. So in New Zealand, that has carried on. Obviously, James Cameron is there now at the studios that Peter Jackson set up, Weta Studios. He's making For Our Sins, Avatar 4, 5, 6, and God knows how many more. But that all started with a small industry in New Zealand. In China, where I was lucky enough to launch several of the Star Movies channels, the fifth generation of filmmakers worked in a lot of the Chinese studios, and then the studios became empty. So the government decided they were going to fill them with animation people, even though the people in the film studios weren't actually animators. So the animators came from Russia and from India and from China and some from the Philippines. And all of a sudden, the government put their money behind animation because they wanted to build, they built cinemas for animation. They built cinemas with 3D. It's the highest proportion of 3D cinemas anywhere in the world, in China. And so now you have huge numbers of animation films being made in China on 3D. And Hollywood comes in and does Kung Fu Panda 3 in 3D, particularly for the Chinese market. The same is true in India. These are all countries who spread culture through their film industry. The Europeans have been doing it for many years. I lived in Hong Kong for 12 years, and for 40 years there, Unifrance had a French film festival every year, bringing culture from Europe into the Hong Kong audience. So I disagree with Ray, because there's structures that are in place through the studios and through cultural organizations and through film commissions that involve thousands and thousands and thousands of people involved in producing this content. There'll always be a market for them in large cinemas where you can go with an audience. Admittedly, my grandchildren watch everything on small tablets or on their mobile phones, but I make sure they go to a movie every month, and I'm 65.
But can I ask you, in the case of New Zealand, where it became a facility for shooting something that wasn't intrinsically a New Zealand film, what difference does that make to the culture if it's a Hollywood, if you're a backlog for Hollywood?
Yeah, Midnight Run was shot in New Zealand. Robert De Niro What it did was that it improved the technical relationships, they improved the studio facilities, the government themselves through New Zealand On Air and through the New Zealand Film Commission, that every year would come to Cannes and every year would have a short film in competition because they nurtured it. Peter Jackson ended up buying one of the old television studios when all of the television studios moved north to the North Island. So Avalon is where Peter Jackson set up his facilities. They developed all the technology there. The internet was in New Zealand 5 or 10 years, way before any of the other English-speaking territories. And so the facilities were built. The training was there through New Zealand On Air. The government got behind it because they realized that something like The Hobbits or something like Lord of the Rings or something like some of the small films, they were punching above their weight. So they actually put money into the film industry and into the television industry to help promote New Zealand as a venue for people to come and shoot films. They made it more easy in terms of tax reductions for people to come there. It's English language, it's very close to Hollywood in terms of people coming there. So they invested a huge amount of money on the basis of it promoting their culture, but also promoting business.
Gulnar, can I bring you in here and ask you what you think, what role you think the government should play in terms of financing films here in Kazakhstan? You know, should they finance them? Should they support the industry? And in what way can that best be affected?
Yes, of course, I'm a patriot of my country. And I shot some of my films in Kazakhstan, and those have become known worldwide thanks to the production and location shooting in Kazakhstan, thanks to the unique culture. But our population is only 17 million, which is very little to make the film fully pay back for itself if it's released only in our country. Therefore, some of my projects, if we talk about production, is when we several producers from different countries come together, and this is about the business components. We come together in order to make sure that the film releases and shown not only in Kazakhstan but in other countries, and to make sure that the film pays for itself. And if we talk about the threshold for Kazakhstan to release the film only in Kazakhstan is $250,000 with the modern digital technologies. So on average, a film that you can shoot in Kazakhstan and so that could be competitive in the global cinema market is a film that costs about $2 million. Therefore, state participation in the development of the cinema business in Kazakhstan is just vital. It's very much necessary. I believe also that cinema is important in terms of the patriotic ideological message for any state, especially for ours, a developing state. Therefore, it is necessary for this component, this share of the movies produced in Kazakhstan to be at between 15% and 20%, like is happening in Russia. Currently, it's between 2% and 5%, which is catastrophically low. And we, one might say, are losing our cinema now in the current conditions of the global crisis and insufficient budget funds, which is very sad. But in principle, I'm a proponent of making the so-called elite films that support cinema as an art. The business component, the business part, of course, is very important. But in the ideological sense, in terms of manipulation, I very much dislike this word in terms of managing the public conscience in any country. The cinema plays a very big role in that. And therefore, such small states with few residents, the support, the assistance from the government is simply necessary for the whole mechanism to start to work, not just the production, but also distribution. And I'd like to note the practice of China, that their system of quotas, the government is very clear in terms of its approach to regulation and in terms of its attitude to propaganda, in terms of allowing foreign films to the market in China, and a lot of films are not able to make it past the censorship. It exists. Charles, you probably agree with that, and are not able to make it into the official quotes set by the government of China. And the Chinese government, therefore, protects its cinema industry this way and provides us with an opportunity to develop. It's unfortunately something that we don't have, and neither does Russia.
That, because, you know, you're talking about big blockbusters in China, Mermaid and Monster Hunt, which don't tend to travel overseas, yeah, as a rule. And then you have the Western ones coming in, and in the middle of that, you have the art house in China, which isn't in such a fantastic state. So maybe just give us an overview.
How much time do we have? taking a step back, before, thank you for bringing up China. I'll once again touch upon that. But before we do that, in this world, you have fundamentally five or six countries with a domestic industry that could support it: the U.S., China, South Korea, Japan, India, Nigeria. The world's biggest film market in terms of quantity comes from Nigeria. Nollywood is an amazing source of content. They make films not for the globe, they make films for the local audience. So first and foremost, films need a primary audience. My company, we specialize in co-productions. China-Malaysia, China-Canada, China-Italy, China, I would love to do one with Kazakhstan one day, but we shot a US movie last year. So we do a lot of this type of international co-productions, but first and foremost, you have to define who is the audience. So who's the source? Secondly, in addition to the audience, you need to talk about the type of films. Is it a commercial film? Is it an art house film? In Europe, when you mention Kazakhstan, I think, you know, the European system is a wonderful source. We are here at the Eurasian Media Summit. If you look at the European film industry, large countries such as the UK or little countries such as Norway and Denmark all have vibrant small film funds. Why? Because local stories need to be told. It goes back to the local. People care about things around them. Yesterday we were talking about news. Local news is what real people care about. Of course, international things are more important, but in reality, people care about local. So with that said, at the global level, art house films, government support, absolutely key. Part two of my answer is for China. China, yes, of course, there's quotas in China, as there are in other parts of this world. But what is more important in China is consumer acceptance. What will the audience want to watch? Everyone here, you've heard of Woody Allen, yes? I'm not sure about your country or here, but I'm sorry, New York Jewish humor will not work in China, right? It's not, even if it could get in, even if you could secure a quota unit. Yes, there are, the official government regulation is 20 revenue sharing films plus 14 3D and IMAX films, but what most people do not know about or care about is what we call flat fee import. There's 50 quota units. It never gets filled. Why? Because most of the time, you know, how do you find, why should a local Chinese audience want to watch about humor that is based in urban America or high school sophomore humor, right? It is what it is.
Mm-mm.
Sorry.
But if you're talking about it as a propaganda tool or soft power, mm-hmm. or, you know, in terms of projecting your the image of your nation and having it seen in the home cinemas that Ray predicts that we'll be doing all of our viewing in, that doesn't necessarily travel best with local comedy, does it? Or local...
To this day, I cannot think of a single Hollywood or a single Chinese film that's worked abroad. Everyone's heard of Crouching Tiger, Hidden Lion. That was, I think, Sony. Or no, it was Miramax. It was Miramax, right? It was shot by Taiwanese, Lian. And it was
written by James, completely
irrelevant. Well, it was nice in China. It was ho-hum. It was a nice movie, but it wasn't anything magical. It was shot for the foreign audience. It wasn't shot for the domestic audience. And so I could keep going back to who is your audience. That is key. The Chinese have tried for years trying to find it's. I go back to the concept: entertainment is local. Right? If you go to American television, I spent a long time in America, but I've been back in China 20 years. But in terms of American television, how many Asian actors are there? How many black actors are there? How many Hispanic-looking actors? Does it reflect society as a whole? It's becoming more and more so now, but I submit it's not. Right? Every country is dominated by a majority culture, and it is to that majority the culture that one targets. And so knowing your audience, whether it's television, internet, or film, is absolutely key. In Chinese films, someone mentioned the fifth generation filmmakers, famous Chinese filmmakers that have traveled all over Europe going to film awards. I submit those movies is what we call poverty porn, right? Because what it is it shows China in a really poor, really backward fact, and I'm not sure if it's feel good by the Westerners. Back in the 90s, China was poor. Today, Europeans still want to, they still kind of want to see poverty porn of people, impoverished people in horrible situations with the government oppressing them, so on and so forth. But the reality is, it's not that bad anymore, right? People travel a lot. People, for the most part, have a decent life. Not everybody, but still, there's a good portion.
Mm-hmm. Ray, I mean, can I ask you about, you talk about the cinema of the future being home or, you know, home-based entertainment. Have you an idea of what people will be watching?
Well, I think I should clarify that I'm not saying there will be no movie theaters. I said there will be perhaps 5% of movies being watched. But the movie theaters and the social experience, you're quite right, Charles, will still be very important. But it will be a special occasion. What I'm convinced of is that we will all have our own movie theaters. Some of you may have them today. But actually, for a young person without much budget, taking one of these and putting on a cardboard headset gives you a giant screen, and with headphones, wonderful sound. We will all have our own movie theaters. And what the future holds for film is an explosion of filmmaking, a most magnificent future. It's not, when I say the death of cinema, I mean the death of the traditional local movie house and the distribution model that feeds it. As to what they want to watch, Finn, they're going to want to watch what they've always wanted to watch, and that is great storytelling. We want to be told stories that move us, that entertain us, that enrich us, that inform us. And yes, of course, film is a political medium. But in the softest sense, no overt piece of propaganda will hold attention and gain a mass audience. If it is political, it is in the softest sense. But cinema is undergoing true disruption. The traditional cinema, like traditional media, like many other sectors of society, banking, finance, politics, are undergoing the most tremendous upheaval, all caused by digital distribution and digital technology. But the art of filmmaking and storytelling will remain unchanged.
I want to ask Oleg and Gulnara as well, in this environment that we're all moving into, where there's going to be such a choice and so much product being made, how do you both think that you can distinguish your product to local audiences and also mark your product out for overseas audiences so that you can get attention and promote your country and your industry?
First of all, I'd like to talk about formats. Actually, people are quite stable in terms of their habits. You probably never thought of it, but the duration of between 90 and 100 minutes is a stable duration of movies that we watch in the movie theaters. Some films are 3 hours long, etc., but there is a clearly defined format that is a movie theater format for us. At the same time, if we watch something at home, we lean more towards the series because we'd like to live together with the characters a longer story than just one that lasts 90 minutes. If we talk about the gadgets, some young people probably watch feature-length movies on their gadgets, but actually, if it is a type of content from YouTube and if you watch it on the phone, most of the time it's about 7 minutes long maximum. So our consumer behavior is predefined. This means by our own psychology and the perceptions that exist perhaps at a physiological level. This is talking about how we like to watch. It is clear that we would go to see IMAX movies with pleasure because no home theater probably would enable a large number of people to watch a product at such a high level of quality. Some people say that soon we'll have not 3D glasses, but glasses without a screen that will have the projection of the imagery and we'll see something like that, and technology will probably change some of the aspects of film watching, but watching this kind of a collective movie-going experience is something that will continue attracting us to the movie theaters when you laugh together, etc. And what was the second part of the question? I'm sorry, I've forgotten.
Can you distinguish your films in the global marketplace, bring them to people's attention?
Hollywood has always specialized on making global cinema, which is a difficult task. To produce a film for the whole world that would be interesting at different markets to totally different people. It seems to me that the national cinema industries, in such a broad sense, should not strive to act like Hollywood does and to produce movies that everyone would watch. One should probably look for the special niches, and for example, our film V, that is based on Gogol's works, highly transformed, but it turned out such that it was distributed in China quite widely, and V2 is made as a co-production with China. So it seems to me that, number one, one needs to make a high-quality product so that it is of interest to the viewers. And secondly, one needs to look for the topics and genres that should be of interest not only locally but beyond. But I don't think that the national cinema industry should not set such an objective for themselves, to make the movie for the whole world. They should focus on their own markets, first and foremost. The question of quotas was already mentioned here, but recently I met with the ambassador of Korea to the Russian Federation, and he told me that not so long ago they've abolished quotas, and they're very much afraid that abolishing quotas will lead to a collapse of their national cinema. It turned out that it continues to account for over 50% of the local markets, both in monetary terms and by number of visits as well. Over 50%. They are just capable to make such a quantity of their own products that attracts the viewer's attention to a much larger degree than other movies that are produced for the whole world. So this is the national mentality that brings us very close. It turns out that the Russian market, the market of Kazakhstan, and the Korean market are very similar in some senses and very different in some respects to the European market. The last point about supporting the cinema industry, if it's made for the whole world, then it's for the whole world, and one can afford then spending $100 million for a single movie. For us, $100 million is the whole government support, divided between 40 to 50 films a year. And all the films shot in the Russian Federation, as a rule, are in the low budget category, below $10 million. Between $2 and $3 million is an acceptable budget for the market in Kazakhstan. I've heard of a number between $100,000 and $300,000 for a film of more or less acceptable quality with quite good distribution prospects, broad distribution prospects. Without government support, at the same time, no local market could exist. It applies not only to the debut movies or the art house in terms of supporting the cinema as an institution, but in terms of distribution, in order for to make sure that the people watch the movie, it needs to be quite expensive to make, and the market turns out to be insufficient to make it pay for itself, which brings us to the objective need for government support for the cinema industry for each local market.
May I? What I would like to say is that what we're seeing now is a pretty interesting thing happening in the world, in the global movie. I would say that films have been divided into two polar parts. The first one is the art house films that are only watched by very few people at film festivals as a rule, and then the other one is commercial movies, and they're there to make sure that the money invested into producing them will be returned later on. And we're talking about films as an art supported by the festivals, and films as a business component and as an ideological component as well. And it's very unfortunate that this is something that is happening now, because my sons, one of them is 20 years old, the other one is 25 years old. They cannot watch festival films unless I make them watch it, because the pace and the storytelling, the style of the storytelling is not something that grabs them. Because they're, you see that the recent two or three generations have been raised with video games, and they perceive such movies and films as a part of the video games, and certainly a big corporations producing such films, they are trying to capture our market as well. Now in May, the famous game that my sons were crazy about throughout 10 years is going to be released, the Worldcraft, and I'm sure that it will beat all possible and impossible collections at the ticket office, as the younger people will go to the movie theater to watch it on a big screen, as they played that game when they were younger, and they will be looking forward to see this second reality on a bigger screen that will make them go through the same nuances, special effects that they had in this video game, but that will be amplified through the living actors, not through animation. And I would say this trend is pretty strong at the moment, and therefore we might lose movies as an art, because films are about picturesque things, performance, and so on and so forth, because films is a business for the big corporations and studios involved in this business. And I'm in favor of preserving films as an art, and it should have the films should have their own identity in every single country and in schools and universities, and we need to teach cinematography, films, just like we teach painting or we teach music and so on and so forth. We might set up the museums of films and cinema, not to lose one of the best components acquired by the humanity, films, because it might make us alert, it might make us grow and sometimes even define our development. Certainly, we being smaller countries in terms of the population and the level of our development, we are not capable of competing with the Hollywood films or with the Chinese blockbusters, and we need to make sure that we support the identity of our films that incites interest, that is genuine, that shows our culture to the whole world. We need to try to do that at a very good, high quality level.
Charles, I'll start with you on this question to ask about cinema as a political tool. Wanted to ask about cinema as a political tool.
Okay.
If we talk about the major U.S. corporations making blockbusters, which are palatable, seem to be palatable around the globe, and they're very much conveying American values. How do you respond?
At one point, was an appendage of several U.S. global corporations. Just if you go back to Hollywood, if you go back to American cinema 75, even 50 years ago, it wasn't meant for the global audience. I cite the example Roman Holiday, post-World War II, Gregory Peck, Audrey Hepburn. It was a couple Americans set in Italy. It was a travel piece for Italy, but it wasn't meant for the Italian audience. It was meant for the American audience. So defining the audience is absolutely key. And so in terms of the US soft power, unlike the China, for example, where there's overt instructions on several political points. In America, for example, something that I care more about, the South China Sea issue. The US is trying to paint China as the aggressor against these poor, smaller countries, so on and so forth. And yet you don't hear a counterpoint to that, and whether it's the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and at some point in the future, Hollywood studios. If it weren't for the Chinese box office, then I'm sure someone in the US would shoot Hunt for Red October 13, set in the South China Sea. So in the US, I don't think it's as overt as, say, some of the Chinese films, not all the Chinese films. In China, there are two, globally, there are artistic films and commercial films. In China, there are what we call red films, you know, things that espouse government values that do not care about box office returns. And then there are commercial movies. There are no true art house movies in China today. That's a controversial statement. Because in China, everything is equity. You have to get your money back. But red films you do not. And so bottom line is summarizing, in the US it perhaps is not as overt. In China some of these films are, but you know, everybody has a personal subjective. It's not objective, it's not neutral. Everyone looks at issues from a personal point of view. We mentioned Ukraine and Russia today at the earlier conference. The Ukrainians look at an incident one way, the Russians look at it another way. Who's right, who's wrong? Well, it depends on whose side you're looking at. Films are the same way.
Mm-hmm. What do you think, Tony, about this? If you look at Britain exporting James Bond around the world as a...
Me or her? No.
Tony.
Well, it's always been the case. I mean, since any of the First or Second World Wars, you know, the governments of every country involved have used cinema either to inform or to encourage or to tell them why the Americans should go to war with the British, or trying to, you know, John Wayne in the Green Berets telling you how you should think about Vietnam. It's always been there, and it's always been there in Korean cinema and Chinese cinema and Russian cinema, any cinema you care to mention. If the government of the day has a point of view that they want to put across, the biggest means of dissemination is through entertainment, either through television or through film, and we can all list serious lists of suggestions of films that have done that. And it's still subtle. Charles has mentioned, you know, the Hollywood studios are still looking for where the villains should come from. Increasingly in America and certainly in parts of Europe, it's big government, it's corporations, it's people that aren't taking care of other people. But at the end of the day, it's entertainment. You need a good guy, you need a bad guy. And since black and white, every country in every country of the world that has a film industry has always used cinema as a means of encouraging, passing information about what they think the public should think about it, nicely wrapped up in a commercial message with some stars and some directors. And it's always going to be the case, and it's more subtle now, but it still happens. There's a lot of independent films made in China. They're not necessarily called red films, we don't necessarily see them, but there's a huge underground filmmaking community there that use digital, as a lot of people around the world are using digital to make films. There's 3,000 new films every year made in various countries. Half of them are crap and should never reach the screen, but the ability of technology to enable people to pick up a digital camera and two or three people with a story, they can make a film for $500,000, $600,000, like they used to do in the early days with what they used to call cut ends or off cuts. They take the end of a 16 mil film or a 35 mil film, put it together, and Paul Morrissey was making movies for £35,000 or dollars. The technology is good on one hand. I mean, the other, there's no restrictions on what these people make in these different countries. There still needs to be a script. There still needs to be people who've got competence and ability to do it. And then obviously it all also needs to be seen. But the history of cinema is always they've used it as a means of manipulation, information, and entertainment.
We've seen the rise of the documentary over recent years with that democratization you're talking about. The lower budgets have encouraged, really, documentary is now very, very
huge,
strong.
Oh, huge, huge.
Could you talk a bit about that?
Documentaries, if you go way back to, again, every single country in the world has had a history of documentary filmmakers, usually sponsored by, in the UK, by, you know, the National Coal Board were making documentaries about coal miners. The same thing happens in New Zealand, the same thing happened in China and all across Europe. Now documentaries are being used, if you think about some of the ones that have actually made their way to the Oscars. There's a lot of documentaries informing people about subjects they wouldn't normally know, about oil pollution, about climate change. I mean, Mr. Gore's film about climate change, you know, completely changed everybody's view about what's actually going on. The same is true of the oil industry. You know, the oil industry, as mentioned yesterday, is now the bad guys, and there's a lot of documentaries being made about that. And the history of documentary filmmakers is they raise their own money. They're not part of a studio system, so they have an independent voice. So it's still hard to get those films seen, but there's more and more documentary film festivals. There's more and more events where funding comes into play so that more and more documentaries that actually have a voice and something to say happens. The Oscars dropped the documentary section like 5 or 6 years ago. There was such an outcry that they had to bring it back. And documentaries now, I think, one of the major forces for information and for bringing some change about. If problem with all of these films that get made every year is the ability for them to be seen.
Yeah. Well, in part, Netflix and Amazon have assisted greatly in the rise of the documentary.
This year in Sundance and last year in Sundance, Sundance has 250 to 300 movies. The top 35 or 40 get picked up by the independent studios who are trying to fill up the rest of their schedule every year. But Amazon and Netflix started buying a lot. Amazon and Netflix are basically repeating the existing pay TV structure of theater, video, online through to free TV. But this year, both in Sundance and Berlin, there was a pushback from the aggressive buying of Netflix and Amazon because the filmmakers themselves turned down some offers, particularly for the big film in Sundance this year, it's called Birth of the Nation. And Fox ended up paying less money than Netflix or Amazon were offering, because Fox would give it a theatrical distribution, it would go to festivals, and then it would be eligible for some awards, because there are still movies that need that kind of cachet and that kind of way forward. Netflix and Amazon are going for the low-hanging fruit. They're replicating the existing pay TV structure that exists. It's cheaper for people to have a Netflix or Amazon subscription than to pay for your package of 30 or 40 channels, which you're forced to do through the pay TV structure. And so if it's only $30 for Netflix or Amazon, they'll take it, as opposed to the $120 they have to pay for a lot of channels they don't want. But the economics of Netflix and Amazon have yet to be proven. And the only way they're going to do that is investing far much more money into original productions, more documentaries, more feature films. That's happening. You'll see a lot of television series that will have Netflix or Amazon as co-production partners, and then they'll go on to HBO, and then they'll go to free TV. So they're playing the same game.
Can I ask Oleg, please, whether Netflix or Amazon or any cable, whether there's been any mirroring of that kind of disruptive force in your country that you've witnessed outside the UK, US markets?
Undoubtedly, those network technologies acquire more and more weight. However, unfortunately, it appears to me that the process of monetization is rather complicated in Russia when it comes to the revenue side from various films, and there are lots of problems there. And the interventions that were taken by the government to fight against illegal content entailed the creation of lots of legal services, including those operating throughout the world, but the producers don't seem to be getting a good return from that. Viewers start watching various types of content, utilizing various types of services, and this is primarily series, not so much feature length pieces. However, it doesn't affect the economy and the business case to the extent that we would like it to. A couple of years ago, we had some projections that apart from the theater runs, this alternative technology-based runs might help get a return for the producers. But so far, we have not achieved this effect.
Thank you. I'd like to talk now to our two experts, Andrei Plakhov and Andrei Tereshchuk. I wonder whether you both have any comment to make on what you have heard today as being the future of the industry and the developments that are taking place.
Good day. First of all, I would like to propose a comment on the first interjection by Reid Hammond regarding the technology revolution that we have gone through and we continue going through, and the opportunities that it creates for the film culture and the art of cinema. I think that those are great opportunities that have been underestimated by us so far. However, apart from the ability to be looking watching films in different formats, apart from IMAX theaters, we can use home-based screens to watch them, and I think that we will continue watching different types of films and movies in special facilities. Sometimes those might be referred to as the museums of cinema, as Gulmira Sarsenova mentioned, the museums of films as the treasuries of films, as museums of arts, and they might have wonderful restored copies of some old films and movies, of classical movies. This will look like an opera theater. And what's amazing about this is that we will be able to watch the opera that was staged in the times of Mozart de Verdi, for instance, the old classical Hitchcock or Charlie Chaplin movies, or some probably less familiar, movies less familiar to us, however, with some probably recordings of an orchestra, for instance, and that would turn those things into large cultural performances. On the other hand, the technology revolution that has occurred provides some of the opportunities of a different kind. We have mentioned that a young man might have a small personal cinema theater in his mobile phone. The same person might not have a lot of money, but at the same time, there is another magic tool in the same mobile phone, a camera. So you can, having a mobile phone and some talent, as well as skills and competences, you can shoot a movie with your mobile phone, and you don't need to go to a movie school for that. And I would say that this creates a very interesting thing that brings together the two subjects of our discussion today, art and business. It looks like those are two different things, but they might be interconnected, not only when we talk about blockbusters, but when we talk about small films. Let me give you an example. Two Russian talented women, Olga Duhovichna and Angelina Nikonova, made a film, a portrait in the dust, and the budget was $10,000, and they shot it with their mobile phone. This was very popular at a film festival. Certainly, this was not something run in a small in a cinema theater. But even with that quality of shooting, this film was awarded with a couple of prizes. Yes, certainly, this is a small business, but it appears to me when they talk about commercial movie making or elite movie making, yeah, indeed, it stands true, but any film is commercial. The issue is what is the scale of that commerce. And then universal films that might be used for the policies to be conveyed in cinematography. Certainly, the movies normally absorb some elements of propaganda. We've had one famous example when the Russian film, Moscow Doesn't Believe in Tears, received an Oscar. This was a long time ago, in 1980. No one expected this to happen. Because back then the Soviet Union went into Afghanistan, the Olympic Games in Moscow were subject to a boycott, and certainly there were some other wonderful films by Kira Kurosawa and François Truffaut presented at that competition. And then finally, very unexpectedly, a film by an unknown Russian director received an Oscar. When the analysts tried to figure out what happened, they were looking at the opinions of the American experts, why the Americans liked that film so much. And the response was that the Americans saw the traditional structure of a melodrama, American fairy tale about Cinderella, who becomes a princess. And in this case, this was the director of the socialist plant. And what they were interested about, is that there were a lot of natural features in that story. It was universal and very original. For instance, a Soviet girl was not trying to meet young man at a discotheque, but she was meeting them at a library. So you see, this is a small example how you can make a universal and an original movie.
The flight crew equipage in 1980. Same year, it came out by a director who was considered one of the main figures in author cinema. But this was a blockbuster, a patriotic film, an adventure, and with an erotic episode, which was probably one of the first ones in the Soviet history. Now we have the new iteration of the flight crew, which a review came out in the Commerce Underspace newspaper, and the readers wrote to me and responded to the review, why is there not the same erotic episode that was there in the original film back in 1980, but the situation is of course totally different. Back then, Moscow Doesn't Believe in Tears, or Equipage, the flight crew, or others that were the distribution leaders, gathered an audience of almost 100 million viewers. Which is a colossal audience, but of course one should take into account that this was in a situation where there was no serious competition from American movies. The number of Western films was subject to tight quotas. Now the story is totally different. The world is open, and As Oleg Ivanov, I think, mentioned, he cited this figure, 10 million viewers is a ceiling for the biggest blockbusters. At some point, Tarkovsky's movies and other great directors had the same audience numbers. So the situation is changing, of course, greatly, and the technology is impacting it, among other factors. But I think we should look for new opportunities, taking into account the new cultural and historical situation, to make sure that both the business component develops and then the culture stays alive as well. It doesn't die. Thank you. Good afternoon. Without a doubt, it's difficult to deny that technology is developing, the technology is growing, continue to grow, probably even faster. But, you know, why are we denying the opportunity for the developing technology in distribution through the movie theaters? 10 years ago, you may remember, no one had a serious attitude towards 3D with those glasses, and no one could think that this could be a large-scale phenomenon. But the technology is developing, not on its own, but specifically because the technology is sought by the masters that create those films. I remember several years ago when James Cameron was presenting at a conference, film materials for Avatar, he said that the script has been ready for 10 years. It's been sitting there for 10 years, but he didn't see an opportunity to create this film using the technology that he wanted. And as soon as he saw an example of a sufficiently good technology, they made it. And this will continue to happen. And the same masters whom we love and who create the films that we remember and know, they're the ones who say that they would like for the films to be seen on the big screen. And this will continue to be the case. There are numerous examples to that, citing the most recent Russian examples. Leviathan is a great example, a wonderful film that received an award for the best script. And the producers have done everything to show this film specifically on the big screen. And obviously this was a correct choice, because the visual perception, what we were all able to see, this was the integral part of the film. This is the modern cinematographic language. And it's difficult for me to imagine a film when such high technology would be available on a mass scale. IMAX today says that they made a notionally home theater system, but it costs $1.5 million. Perhaps it may become affordable later on, which would make me very happy, but it's still far from that. So technology continues to develop, and it applies to cinema distribution as well, and that instills hope in me. Thank you.
I'd like to open it up for audience questions now. If anybody, sir, anybody has anything to ask, now's the time.
I'm Harry Nanda from Toronto, Canada. My question is for Charles, that you have time and again emphasized, know your audience when you're making the movie. I'll take the example of two movies, and I would like to ask you that what were the filmmakers thinking about the audience when they made movie? For example, Borat. When they made the movie, obviously the Kazakh audience was not their target audience. Similarly, the movie Interview, was it made for the American audience, or was it made for the South Korean audience to lampoon the North Korean dictator? Who was the audience of these two movies?
Very interesting question.
Yes, the first one was absolutely an English person. He had a character. He was just basically using an existing character in an interesting situation. So it was absolutely for the US audience. Keep in mind, there's in America, for example, you have what are known as the studio films, right? Your Sony's, your Warner's, your Disney's, your Fox, your Paramount, your Universal. Those are the six studio films. I forgot who released Borat, but it was definitely a studio film targeting the mass audience. For the US per se, spillover into the rest of the world, not necessarily for China. Will Borat work in China? It's not that funny. Right, for a Chinese audience, so it's definitely for a Western audience. The dictator, did you say?
The interview, the Sony one.
Okay, the interview. I'm sorry, I'm having a brain blank right now because I'm thinking about the dictator,
that caused all that trouble, the North Korean with North
Just
Korean.
Just recently, I'm sorry,
last Christmas. Kim Jong-il took, was
the interview. Yes, exactly. That was a Sony hack. That's the movie I was thinking of. For some reason, I thought it was called The Dictator. If you look at the Sony movie, it was a package deal. That wasn't necessarily the main movie. It was for the American comedian, I forgot his name. It was a package deal. It was to get him to make something else if they brought that in. Right, so the interview wasn't the main film per se. It was a stupid movie. I actually watched it after all that publicity. I didn't think it was that funny. Right? But having said that, it wasn't meant for an Asian audience, absolutely. Someone mentioned Korean movies. Korean movies, on average, cost about $3 million U.S. and its equivalent. It punches way above its weight. They're amazing, beautifully made films. And they only target Korean audiences. I mean, there's 40 to 50 million people in Korea. They hit 10 million admissions, right? Just in the Korean market alone for some of these films. And the production quality is every bit as good as Hollywood, I submit. I go to the American film market in November every year. Studio films are great, but American indie films, frankly, aren't that great, especially compared to Korean movies. The production quality. And so money isn't everything. Back to your point, that wasn't meant for a global audience. That was meant for a sophomoric American audience. Did that answer your question?
Have we got any other questions? None so far. Well, to carry on, now that we've brought up the interview and the Sony hack, do you think that Charles, that made people very much more careful in the States about what subjects they take on?
Once again, where the topic is business and politics. I think from a studio point of view, you don't have Washington, D.C., you don't have the National Endowment for Democracy telling Hollywood studios what to make, right? With that said, studios care about investment returns, right? And oftentimes, studios, they don't make the films themselves. They basically have script development executives that basically look at it, and somewhere in the approvals chain, someone says, okay, well, this is a film that we ought to make, and then they hire people to make it. They don't own the filmmakers. They get the directors. They get the, it could be in-house producers. The whole system is you have all these contractors making it to make the film, and then the studios are a sales agency. They're basically in existence to sell movies, right? Films are products for studios, unlike in Europe, where it's a cultural product, where it's treated as art, where because the markets individually are smaller, they cannot afford to, and so without government support to make these films. And so
Do you think, Ray, that this becomes self-censorship, and that ultimately we're heading down a road where it becomes filmmaking becomes more tame?
Absolutely not. Oh. No, I don't think there's any chance of that at all. And the main reason, as you said, is that every single person with an iPhone, with an Android phone, with a smartphone, is potentially a videographer, a filmmaker. And I am a writer. That's how I started. I'm the author of many, many books. But I have in recent years had to learn, and I've wanted to learn, how to make little films, because it is the new language of communication. And I actually see going forward the opposite of censorship. I see going forward the ability of ordinary people to make movies, even if they're only for consumption by their friends, by their family, via social media. I see this as intensely liberating. It is an example of the technology disrupt. These tools for filmmaking were once only in the hands of people who had a lot of money, governments and corporations and so on. And it may well be that the ordinary person like myself will never be able to make a movie that anybody other than my friends and family will ever want to watch. But that isn't the point. I have the ability now to make that sort of movie, that sort of statement, even if it is only of a family event, of something that happens that's important to my friends. Essentially, My discussion about the impact of technology on filmmaking boils down to a fairly simple observation, and that is that our language that we use for film, such as cinema and studios and so on, movie theatres, is out of date. We, by definition, don't have a language for the future. For example, when movies first came along, in the English language, we called them talking pictures. And when an automobile was first invented in the English language, we called it a horseless carriage. And now we're talking about this device, the mobile phone, but we're saying it can make movies. We're saying it can, it's a camera. We're saying it can do all sorts of things. So we don't yet have the language for the arena, the area of life we're moving into. What I'm certain of is that filmmaking, movie making, storytelling in visual images has a far bigger future ahead of it than it has in its history. And of course, that history is glorious, but the future is much more so. It is also going to be an enormous tool for political use because it's coming into the hands of the people. It was impossible until recently for any political movement to fund a film, especially if it was a small movement. Today that has become possible. And finally, in this little part of my contribution, I want to say that I understand why, in establishment terms, it seems as if the likes of Netflix and Amazon and other similar services are the newcomers who are still learning the ropes. But Netflix alone has a budget of $5 billion this year for original filmmaking. $5 billion. Not many other studios can match that sort of creative budget, and that's only the beginning. The future of film enjoyment is both out in a movie theatre with friends and at home, but it will also be new forms of movie like virtual reality, in which we can step into stories, in which we can become part of the experience. The world that's waiting for us all in terms of visual storytelling is spectacular and exciting. And I'm sorry if that when I talk about the death of cinema, it sounds pessimistic. I am the opposite of that. I believe the future for the moving image is fantastic.
That's very optimistic. Have we got any? Oh, Sarah, can I hear from you?
Thank you, Oleg Kimonov, Astana. If we say today that the Dream Factory is an instrument to manipulate society, and manipulation not in good faith, specifically, then you know perhaps such manipulation should be neutralized some way. And perhaps film critics is what can cross the T's and dot the I's and not allow this manipulation. We know that the critics examine the film from an artistic point of view in terms of the work of the director, perhaps, but perhaps what is required today is a political analysis. We talk about manipulating society. I will cite an example. Several years ago, I'm just speaking as a viewer. Several years ago, I watched Lincoln. It was a very expensive film. It was quite boring. Basically, a lot of monologues, a lot of words, and the idea boils down that Abraham Lincoln, the president, thinks about the Civil War, and 300,000 people died. And he says that basically 300,000 people died, but on the other hand, we have democracy. I think it reminds one of Syria or Libya a lot. So it's working with a mass conscience. But someone must prevent this, perhaps. And here I would like to support my compatriot Gulnara Sarsenova, related to the point about patriotic films. And this is related to what Charles mentioned yesterday, where you'd find a good film about China in the West, he said. So perhaps as part of the work of the film critics, perhaps political analysis has a place, or as well as sociological analysis, etc.
We have another question? Oh, sir.
When we talk about preserving the local, the national film industry in the countries where the population is quite small, relatively small, one should remember that cultural sovereignty is an integral part of the national sovereignty of any country, and the need to support the national film industry is obvious. But how the creative people and the producers should act, the robbery Kazakh style, quite an interesting film, quite professionally made Kazakh film, it could have been shown not only in Kazakhstan, but there are some miscalculations by the producers. If the producers want for a film to be shown in Russia, for instance, you know, one should think perhaps about introducing one Russian actor. I have some experience of joint projects, feature films with Azerbaijan, documentary projects with China, and I launched the first project for serious joint projects between Russia and China, and I think that we need to express our local national features, looking for co-production opportunities first and foremost among similar cultures in neighboring countries. And in that sense, the co-production between Russia and Kazakhstan, if it became systematic, without a doubt would facilitate the development of the national cinema industry in Kazakhstan, and then distribution of the product in Russia, and without a doubt, the Russian cinema industry would also win. As for China, actually, in China, the urban and the rural audiences are very different. But if one of our partners, the producer of the Blind Massage movie, that 3 years ago in Berlin, received the Silver Bear and then the Asian Oscars, 2 or 3. And he released this film on the same date for distribution in 22,500 film movie theaters. Of course, such a scale is not attainable yet, at least for the Russian market, and naturally not attainable for the market in Kazakhstan. Co-production with China is very complicated. We are preparing the very first joint Russian-Chinese pitching of the joint projects at the festival in Sevastopol, of the documentary festival that we are conducting for the 12th year in a row now. It has received information on over 200 projects. Out of them, if you look at what's published on the festival's website, they've published a long list of those projects already. And I think the Kazakh colleagues could get involved in this as well, and perhaps get some additional opportunities for the development of their national, their local cinema industry. Thank you.
I'd like to respond to the first question. You know, it appears to me that if the Dream Factory allows us to manipulate then at the level of film criticism, you might create some sort of a political tool or something. I think that, in fact, posing or formulating this question like that is not quite appropriate, because if the art is used to manipulate, then it's up to the viewers to manage it. However, is the audience healthy enough in terms of its morale not to allow for others to use different tools to manipulate that audience? So only that moral health of the audience will disallow such a manipulation. And in fact, we do a lot looking at the viewers in Russia, and we're trying to see why viewers like going to the theater, to the movie theater, because they like imitating the behavior of the character that they like. They like to see things that they have never seen before. They like when the story is told in a very vivid and colorful way, that is something in a way that is unusual to them. So we should not be looking towards having some sort of a struggle or a fight, but we need to develop our cinematography in such a way so that it would be interesting to the viewer. And that way we could address the problem, in my point of view. Although there might be certain tools or instruments, however, turning cinematography into an institute that would fight against this influence at the political levels is somewhat strange. It looks bizarre from my point of view. It's not quite objective. Film critics cannot prompt things to the large audience because the audience feels things for itself. Well, I would like to add on to that and to answer your question. In my point of view, it's not about the role of the film critics, it's the role of the mass media in every single country. They're supposed to be telling people and to explain what is good and what is bad. And in my point of view, I would urge the journalists here, please help people watch good movies. Help people love those good films, because any good film will make a person better.
Sadly, time has flown away with us. It's a very interesting discussion. I'm sure it will carry on afterwards, but I'd like to just say thank you to our two experts in the audience and also to everyone on the panel for such an interesting conversation today. Tony, Gulnara, Charlie, Ray, and Oleg. Thank you very, very much indeed for your contribution.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, a big thank you to Fionnuala Halligan and her panel for discussing that. A wide variety of topics we cover, as you know, at the forum, so it's interesting to see different angles on these issues and topics. It's always sad to see us come to a close now after such an intense few days of discussions and ideas being exchanged. I think those of you who have come for the first time can see how the forum is one where people are open to express their views, and it's quite a lively debate environment. And I think a lot of that comes down to, two things in particular, the leadership of the organizing committee, and Dr. Deriga, I thank you for that, and really the volunteers. So a big round of applause for all the young volunteers who've done so much. They make the life of moderators like myself and speakers very easy, because they really are very organized, so thank you. I also want to, of course, invite up the chairperson of the organizing committee, Dr. Deriga Nazarbayeva, to officially close the forum as well. Please come.
Dear friends, dear colleagues, unfortunately, the work of our forum has come to an end. I say unfortunately and regretfully, because we have gotten used to seeing every single one of you. We have gotten to love you, and we would love to see you once again next year at our forum. Certainly no similar event happens without financial support from a big number of good friends and successful companies who provide their support to us. Let me go through the list. The general sponsor for the forum is the joint stock company Samru Kazina. The official airline is the joint stock company Air Astana. The sponsors, GTI Kazakhstan, the Eurasian Group, Philip Morris Kazakhstan, Kazzinc, Renko Cat, Center Credit Bank, our partners, the national company Astana Expo 2017, the Akimat of the city of Astana, the Astana Convention Bureau, the Nazarbayev University, the National Academic Theater of Opera and Ballet, Astana Opera, the Rixos President Hotel in Astana, the Media Gurus Company, Kagorkin Multispace Astana, our media partners, the TV channel KTK, the TV channel CNN, Habar channel, the information portal Zekon.kz, the information portal BNews.kz, and Euroback. We've had our favorite and permanent foreign group working with us, our beloved Rizkhan. Thank you very much. Susan Phillips. Steven Somerville. I don't see him. And of course, the organizing committee of the forum and our volunteers. Allow me to provide some of the statistics on our forum. The total number of mass media outlets who actively participated in the work of our forum is 185. Out of that number, 82 foreign media, 103 Kazakhstan-based media. The total number of forum delegates, 567. Out of that, 248 foreign delegates. Speakers and experts, 48 individuals. I would like to express my special gratitude to them for having made their way to arrive here and for being so generous in sharing their experience and knowledge. Let's give them a round of applause. Dear friends, in conclusion, please allow me to voice some of my observations that I've had as I've been through 13 fora.
Digital technologies development, modern media affects and changes not only the material world, it changes the culture, the traditional values. It makes adjustments to the spiritual world of people. In my opinion, all the painful processes in the modern world are not the manifestations of the conflict between civilizations. They are the processes of adaptation, the overlapping of different civilizations with each other. This is a painful, dramatic, and long-term process. Perhaps several generations will pass before human civilization will enter the common path of harmony, mutual understanding, and peace. Humanity does not have other alternatives. Walls should be built. Walls should not be built, they should be destroyed. No country is able to survive in isolation, especially when digital communications and the internet encourage people to seek a better life, and it makes the government look for new revenue streams and create new jobs. They say that everything can be digitized. But I believe that it's impossible to digitize our conscience, our soul, our mind, which are in constant search for answers to eternal questions. Why it happens, who is to blame, and what to do. Consequently, such discussion platforms will always be in demand. Thank you very much for these interesting discussions and for the opportunity to see the problems from different angles. Such constructive discussions cast doubt on the customary stereotypes. This is a good result. Thank you so much for that. As you know, next year, Kazakhstan will be the host country of the World International Exhibition, the sites of which you'll be visiting today in the afternoon during the Astana City Tour. And I am pleased to announce that the next 14th Eurasian Media Forum will take place on June 22-23 next year at the one of the sites of Astana Expo 2017. I will be happy to see you there next year. I wish all of you good luck, a lot of success, strong health and prosperity. And see you tonight here.
Dr. Dariga, thank you very much for officially closing the forum. I should point out there are a couple of activities still continuing. As Dr. Dariga Nazarbayeva explained, we will be going around on a city tour and checking the site of the forum. But don't forget, there's a masterclass in digital journalism starting at 2:30 p.m. This afternoon with Russian TV presenter Alexei Pivovarov. So we'll see you, of course, around as things haven't ended, so to speak, in terms of where we're all here. But the forum is officially closed, and I thank you again, Dr. Dariga, for your country's wonderful hospitality for those of us who've come from outside. Thank you very much. Have a good afternoon, everyone.